How to write the perfect invention disclosure then? I mean, you already guessed it probably. In the end, it's all about really convincing the patent examiner that it's a non-obvious solution to a technical problem. That's really the bottom line. That's what we have to convince the patent examiner of. And to that end, we need good disclosure in the patent application. Because the problem is, after the patent application was filed with the patent office, we cannot add additional technical details to it. So the solution, how we have explained it in the patent application is fixed then. We can also make additional arguments later on in the discussion with the patent examiner, but we cannot add technical substance, so to say. The substance has to be in the patent application in the first place. How do we do that? Just some general tips. So when you are writing your invention disclosure document, please don't try to write a patent. Even if you've read a lot of patents, you will see that's a special language because it's a mix of technical and legal language. They talk about things like embodiments and certain legal terminology has a very specific meaning. And please, as a developer, don't try to be a patent attorney. Don't try to write a patent. Just write your invention disclosure in plain technical language. No legalese, please. And on the other hand, but also please avoid company internal language, you know. So just stick to commonly accepted technical language in your field. And specifically concerning software inventions, don't try to make it sound physical or tangible if it really isn't. If the invention is about an algorithm, just explain how the algorithm works on a functional level. Maybe make a flowchart and just explain which functions are executed by the algorithm. What's the input? What's the output? What does it do? How does it do it? Don't try to, let's say, disguise the algorithm into something machine-like, like, I don't know, an interface module and an encoder module. Just say the data is encoded using this and that algorithm. Just focus on the function, if the invention is about the function. Of course, if the invention is about a really hardware-based invention, at the interplay of software and hardware, of course you have to explain the hardware part of it as well. But if the invention really is about software, just focus on the function. Write an elevator pitch. That would be very nice. If you maybe at the end, if you've drafted the whole invention disclosure, maybe take a step back and imagine you would have to explain your invention to someone on the elevator. You have 1 minute until the elevator door opens and everyone goes where he goes. So you have a couple of sentences to explain your invention. And the story for a patent is always the same. The structure is always like here in this template. You could really use this template for your elevator pitch. The structure is always, well, we are talking about the field of industrial robots or cobots specifically. Here, everyone in the industry today does this and that. But the problem is that some problem you encountered in the known solutions. And now your invention solves this problem by, and then you would need to try to, let's say, carve out a very high level, mostly functional explanation of really the inventive gist, the concept, which then covers all the specific facets of how you really implement it. You know, this is really the masterclass, so to say. And this is what we really have to work out before we file the patent application. On the one hand, I have to know, and we have to present this in the application, we have to know the concrete realization, how it is really implemented in practice so that it works. That's the one part of the deal I was talking about. We have to inform the public in the patent application how the invention works in such a level that any skilled practitioner, any average practitioner could build it when he reads the application. And on the other hand, to get a as broad as possible scope for the monopoly, I have to understand what's really the conceptual difference over the prior art. How do we do that in the end? Well, these are the questions. I can also, of course, provide you these slides afterwards. Maybe that's a little helpful checklist for you in the end when you come up with invention disclosures. We need the inventive principle, as I said, so we have to really explain which technical problems are solved by your innovation. How does the invention solve these problems on a principle layer? Why is that better than the known approaches, the known solutions to this point in time? And why is your solution kind of uncommon, kind of surprising? Why did it take some time for you to come up with this solution? That's the inventive principle that has to be clear in the invention disclosure. And on the other hand, we need to disclose the concrete realization, as I said. So how can the invention be put into practice? How is it put into practice in your prototype, for example? Possible workarounds also. How could it be put into practice? Although you maybe didn't build it in that way, or maybe it's not even feasible today, given the technology we have, but what would be possible workarounds, let's say in 15 years maybe? And would be really helpful would be to have one complete walkthrough. So in addition to this inventive conceptual discussion of the invention, I really need, as a patent attorney, really one complete walkthrough with concrete data, with examples, inputs, outputs, how it works, intermediate results, just play the invention through the algorithm, if it's an algorithmic invention, with concrete data sets, so that everyone can really see how it works in one particular example. And then, of course, as I said, to take this first hurdle, most of the time, I guess, if it's really about robotics here or about things like industrial automation, smart factories, cloud computing, these things are rather on the technical side, and we probably don't face any fundamental problems here. But on the other hand, we need to really prepare the stage for the patent prosecution procedure, and we really need to add into the patent application why it is technical. So any conceivable technical applications, use cases should go into the patent application and into your invention disclosure. Particularly important if your invention is, for example, more on the conceptual side, for example, in AI and machine learning. So if you came up with some kind of new AI training algorithm and you say, hey, this is so cool, it is applicable to almost to a broad range of problems, you know, not only to robotics, but it's really some kind of a scientific breakthrough even. Probably we don't get a patent for the scientific breakthrough as such, because that is non-technical, but we get patents for the technical applications of this scientific concept, and therefore we need all the conceivable technical applications and use cases in there. Also, any technical considerations about the hardware, because that's another way how to make AI technical, irrespective of a particular use case. If you can say that your AI algorithm or your software algorithm in general is the design of the algorithm is motivated by the underlying hardware. So an example would be that you structure your data in such a way that it can be processed by the instruction set in a GPU particularly fast, you know? So if the design of the algorithm takes account of the underlying hardware platform, that's also how to make a software invention technical. And of course, you should always include what's the overall competitive advantage, be it technical or not. Maybe it will not end up in the patent application, but it's important for me to know what's the user advantage, the user benefit of your invention, so that I can draft a broad monopoly in the end. I think it's the last point. Yeah, exactly, the invention hierarchy. So in the end, what I said is what we need is we need the the concrete technical realization, how you really put your invention into practice, really in concrete terms. But if we had a patent only for this specific implementation, the patent would be very narrow in terms of the scope, because your competitor could just do one little screw down there, let's say, one little part of the algorithm differently, and he would be out of the scope of protection. So again, what we need is we need a hierarchy. We need to generalize out of the concrete realization. We need to generalize the inventive concept, really, and then we have to build together some kind of hierarchy so that I then can start in my negotiations with the patent office with the broad concept and say, look, this broad concept is already inventive on that level. We need to get a patent on that, and we deserve a patent on the concept already. And then if the examiner finds prior art, which already maybe anticipates the major aspects of the broad concept, we need fallback positions, step-by-step fallback positions, to limit our desired scope, to circumvent, to work around what the examiner has faced us with, and this is then kind of a cascade down until we eventually end up with the concrete realization. So this also should be clear in the invention disclosure. What are the known features you are using, which are necessary for the invention to work, but which are as such already common? Which are the unique features of your invention? And talking about the unique part of your invention, you should make clear what is really necessary, which subset of the unique features is really necessary for the invention to work, which is, let's say, the minimum viable conceptual model, and which features are then optional, add-on, nice-to-have features, which bring certain advantages but are not absolutely necessary.